I have a few shirts that have a little saying on them. You've probably seen a lot of these kinds of shirts. It says, "Life is good." One has a little golfer and so forth. They have quite a line of clothing. And that's true. Life is good when you know the Lord Jesus Christ. But I'm starting a new line of shirts. It's going to say, "Life is terrible." T-A-R-E-I-B-L-E. What do Charles Barkley and George W. Bush have in common? They both say terrible. Life is terrible. But the Bible says that life can be good in many ways when you walk with the Lord Jesus Christ and do what the Word of God says. But otherwise, we know from what the Word of God says that life on the planet Earth is terrible. T-A-R-E is the King James word for weed, W-E-E-D. And we will see that there are weeds growing in life all over the place. And of course, the reason is because the first Adam took the choke and decided to disobey God and ruin everything. Now, because of that, 1 Timothy chapter 2, beginning at verse 1, says, and we'll get to the parable of the tares and the wheat momentarily, but listen to this, 1 Timothy 2, 1. "I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and for all those in authority, so that we, Christians, may live," because this is written to Christians, the Bible is written for people who believe God's word, people who say nuts to that, it's not going to benefit them, it's not addressed to unbelievers. Well, there's one part that is, you know what it says to you if you are not a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ? It says, get a life. Get saved from sin and death. Be a believer so that you can really start living life as God intended it, at least to some degree. At least you know what to do with the terrible tares that you find. And so it says that we may live peaceable and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. We need to pray that government officials do not make insane decisions and policies that take our freedom and our prosperity, and especially in some places today where it's absolutely illegal to be a Christian, and there's a death penalty for converting people to Christianity. Thank God that I live in the United States of America, where, at least so far, I don't have to deal with something like that. Verse 3, listen to this. "This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and come unto a knowledge," it's a thoroughly applied knowledge, "of the truth," the one and only truth, which of course is referring to His Word, because God's the only author of truth. Everything else is opinion. And you know what they say about opinions, okay? And then it says, He wants all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. Here's the chewy caramel center of the truth. There's one God, count them, one, and one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus, who gave Himself as a ransom for all men. Wait a minute. Why did He have to do that? Gave Himself as a ransom for all men. Let me finish the verse. The testimony given in its proper time, right in the right moment, Jesus showed up and stood in the gap for all mankind. Why did He have to do that? Because the first Adam ruined everything and produced a fallen race on a ruined planet. Now, look at Matthew chapter 13, and we'll see this parable about the tares and the wheat. Now, excuse me, we just read that God wants all men to be saved and come unto a thorough knowledge of the truth. Is it happening? I don't think so. There are millions of people who are saying no to God. The choice is yours, remember. You're not a robot. You can say yes to God and Christ, or you can say, forget it. I'm going to believe what I made up. I'm going to make up my own God. But it won't work. It will not stand you in good stead in the crucible of life. It'll let you down. Be like a rubber crutch when you need it. Okay? So here is a very telling parable by Jesus when he was speaking Matthew 13, 24. And he is talking to the folks, and he says, he told them another parable. Now remember, vital, look at all the red letters in my Bible. Some Bibles have the words of Jesus in red letters, okay? Jesus knew nothing about Christianity. He never heard of a Christian, never saw of a Christian, and he never said anything before his resurrection, before his death and resurrection. Nothing he said was directed specifically to Christians. We have many more things on our website, on our YouTube channel, about what parts of the Bible are written to whom, past, present, future, Jew, Gentile, Christian. Gotta get that straight. Now, many things that Jesus said, principles apply to us today, but you gotta be careful, or you'll be trying to live by someone else's mail. You'll be reading someone else's mail, trying to do what he's supposed to be doing in another time zone, and it ain't gonna work. So he says the kingdom of heaven, that's in the future. Kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God are both in the future after Jesus comes back to the earth. Remember, he's gonna take the church out. 7 years later, he comes back to the earth. I have a three-hour teaching on this right on our website, the administrations in Scripture, with a chart that shows you the whole Bible on one page. It's definitely worth your time if you want to know the Word of God. Because without understanding the administrations in Scripture, you'll never understand it. It won't make any sense. And then it'll be frustrating because you'll be trying to go by what's written to someone else. It says, it's like a man who sowed good seed in his field. Okay, got it? Farmer analogy out there, sowing in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed tares. It's an old word for weeds. And they're not just little weeds, they're big weeds that try to choke the crop sometimes. His enemy came and sowed weeds. He sowed tares among the wheat, and he went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed weeds, then the weeds formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, "Yikes, boss, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Well, what's up with all the weeds in there? An enemy did this," he replied. The servants asked him, "Do you want us to go and pull up the weeds?" He answered, "No, because while you're pulling up the weeds, you might root up the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. At that time, I will tell the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn." And when we continue in part two to close this particular teaching, we're going to ask the same question that Jesus' disciples did. What the heck are you talking about? Because Jesus will explain it, and then we'll look at an awesome section in 2 Peter chapter 3, which shows that God does want all men to be saved, And he's giving everyone as much of a chance as he possibly can. Stay tuned for that one.